Hare Krishna, we continue with chapter 3 of Bhagavad Gita, Karma Yoga. In this third chapter, Krishna explains that everyone must engage in some sort of activity. But actions can either bind one to this material world or liberate one from it. By acting for the pleasure of the Supreme without selfish motives, one can be liberated from the law of karma and attain transcendental knowledge of the Self and the Supreme. The chapter starts with a question Arjuna asks, what is better, renunciation or work? In the previous chapter, Krishna advised Arjuna to keep all abominable activities far distant by the yoga of intelligence, devotional service or Bodhi yoga, and in that consciousness to surrender unto the Lord. So this was confusing for Arjuna because he thinks that intelligence means inaction. Therefore, he asks, if he is to keep abominable activities far away by intelligence, why does Krishna urge him to fight in the most abominable of all wars, where he has to kill his own relatives in order to secure a worldly kingdom? Thus, he wants to get clear on this. He wants Krishna to clear up this apparent confusion for his benefit and for ours too. Arjuna, this thought of Krishna consciousness or Bodhi yoga or Bhakti yoga or intelligence in spiritual advancement of knowledge as something like retirement from active life and the practice of penance and austerity in a secluded place. In other words, he wanted to skillfully avoid the fighting by using Krishna consciousness as an excuse. But as a sincere student, he placed this question before his master and questioned Krishna as to his best course of action. In answer, Krishna explains karma yoga or working Krishna consciousness in this chapter 3. In the second chapter, Krishna explained already detached work, karma yoga, and cultivation of spiritual knowledge or jnana yoga. The problem is that Arjuna misunderstood that these are two different incompatible processes leading to different goals and that he should choose one of them. Therefore, Arjuna asked Krishna to tell him decisively which process is the best. The Lord answers that jnana and karma are in fact two stages of the same progression and thus they are not contradictory. Arjuna should combine them and thus free himself from the bondage of work. Krishna uses the word nishta or steadiness in singular rather than in dual to indicate that there is only one steadiness in the sense that both types of nishta, karma yoga and jnana yoga, being fixed in karma yoga and jnana yoga, have only one goal, that of realizing our spiritual nature. There are not two nishtas with two different methods and goals, but rather one process of two types with the same goal. In other words, one should not be carried away by the superficial differences in the details, but should rather see the unifying principle behind. At first sight, the processes of karma and jnana are different, even opposite. Karma means to continue our work in this world according to our nature, following the injunctions of the scriptures, with the goal of attaining liberation in the future. Jnana, on the other hand, entails rejection of material work and full dedication to direct cultivation of spiritual knowledge. Thus, although karma and jnana look different, in reality they share the same goal, which is liberation, and are just two different stages of the path to attaining liberation. Of course, this does not mean that everything is one, yatamat, tatapat, all this bogus mayavadi nonsense, and that all paths lead to the same goal, as Krishna will explain later on. Although it is true that there is only one path, one can still decide which way to go. One could still choose to turn away from God and to go to the opposite direction. But by ignoring God, by ignoring Krishna, one will still attain a destination that is predestined by God for those who ignore him. Thus, there is no escape from the control of God. Moreover, later on Krishna will explain that those who worship demigods go to the demigods, those who worship the Pitris, the predecessors, they go to their planet, and those who worship ghosts and spirits, they live with these beings. And those who worship him, Krishna, they go to Goloka Vrindavana and they live with Krishna. Working knowledge is better than false renunciation. In the beginning of this third chapter, Arjuna asks which is better, renunciation or work. So Krishna explains that since selfish activities bring bondage, and inaction is actually impossible because the soul is always active, then detached work for his pleasure is the best course of action. As already pointed out, there are two ways by which the self can be realized. These are the process of detached work, or karma yoga, or buddhi yoga, and the process of philosophical speculation, which entails renouncing the work, or jnana yoga. Both processes are authoritative, but the detached work is more natural, it's safer, and this by far more popular option. While performing karma yoga, or detached work, one should guard on one hand against attachment for the results of his work, and on another hand, against premature renunciation. So these are the two extremes we should try to avoid. The method of renunciation of work and engaging solely only in study of scriptures and meditation, jnana yoga, can be adopted only after sufficient purification through performance of prescribed duties. It should not be done whimsically or sentimentally. So we all have material desires, and trying to fulfill them independently from the Vedic injunctions will not bring us happiness. It will only entangle us more in the material illusion. When we try to fulfill our desires in a pious, regulated way, with the goal of purification and spiritual advancement, we will gradually lose our taste for material enjoyment. This is the benefit. We will realize that actually satisfying the urges of the senses brings very meager fulfillment, which is compared to drop of water in the desert. It doesn't justify the tremendous amount of work and time that it requires. We will gradually notice that the spiritual activities like hearing and chanting the holy name of Krishna, discussing his pastimes in the company of his pure devotees, etc., bring much greater satisfaction than the stale and trivial material affairs. Then renunciation will come naturally as a result of our purification. On the other hand, premature renunciation cannot actually purify the heart. Thus, the honest householder engaged in performance of his prescribed duties is better than the pretender yogi engaged in the so-called spirituality only to attain an easy life and to avoid responsibility. Without purification of the heart, the acceptance of the life of renunciation is simply a disturbance of the social order. Srila Prabhupada gives the example of the honest sweeper on the street. He is much better situated because he's honest. He honestly performs his duties. And the pretender meditator who meditates, who performs so-called meditation, austerity, spirituality, only to fill up his belly. This is not recommended. Arjuna wanted to renounce his social obligations prematurely, not because of purification, but out of frustration caused by inability to achieve his selfish desires. Instead of performing his duty of a warrior, Arjuna wanted to remain inactive and to live an idle life of frustration. Terrible as it sounds, it is also impossible. By definition, the soul cannot remain inactive, even for a moment. Many people think that since the materialistic persons are usually very active, because they are busy securing sense enjoyment, the spiritual person should be passive. However, it is not a question of materialistic life, but it is the very nature of the soul to be always active. The body is only a dead vehicle to be worked by the spirit soul, which is always active and cannot stop even for a moment. Therefore, the soul has to be engaged in the good work of spiritual advancement or Krishna consciousness. Otherwise, it will be engaged in occupational duties, so-called, dictated by the illusory energy of the Lord. So, since inactivity is not an option, Arjuna's only choice is between proper and improper activities. The proper activities should be performed with proper consciousness. One should act not only with detachment, but with desire to please the Lord. One must not enjoy the fruits of his work himself, but must dedicate the same for the transcendental loving service of personality of Godhead. So work should be done as a sacrifice for Krishna, for God. Otherwise, work binds one to this material world because you do it for yourself. Then you have to accept the consequences, which will be always good, bad, and mixed. So therefore, Krishna tells Arjuna, perform your duties for my satisfaction. And in this way, you will always remain free from bondage. In this way, Krishna introduces a very important topic, the topic of sacrifice. If we want to be normal and happy human beings, we must offer our life as a sacrifice to a cause greater than our selfish, trivial sense enjoyment. So human life is actually meant for yajna or for sacrifice. In the beginning of this chapter, Krishna described karma yoga, or working without material desires for the pleasure of the Lord. But wait a moment, what if I am full of material desires and thus unable to come up to this lofty ideal? I can work only when I am motivated by a desire to enjoy the fruit of my work, somebody can say. But there is no problem. Since Krishna is omniscient, he anticipated these questions like 5,000 years ago. So he explains that if one cannot work without material desires, he should still perform his duties. In other words, if you cannot work without desires, you have to work with desires. That's all you got. But you should never abandon your duties. So if one is unable to perform karma yoga, which means to have transcendental object of liberation, because he's too much attached to material things, then he should engage in the karmakanda rituals described in the Vedas. These rituals are meant for those who want to enjoy material facilities and include worship of different demigods. Thus, karmakanda brings material enjoyment in heaven and on earth, but more importantly, it gives a chance for further progress to the stage of accepting a spiritual goal, which is karma yoga. Karmakanda and karma yoga, they might look very similar or the same, but the consciousness of the performer is different. The karma yogi, he wants to attain liberation, Brahman or Krishna or Paramatma. A karmakandi, he wants to attain so-called material happiness inside the material universe. He wants to stay here and to enjoy here. So the purification of the karmakandi is possible because he accepts the authority of the Vedas. He partakes in the sanctified food and associates with learned Brahmana priests. In this way, gradually he can realize that Krishna and not the demigods is the supreme enjoyer of all sacrifices. He slowly understands that material existence means suffering and that the only solution to all problems of life is to return back home, back to Godhead by the process of devotional service. So this progress is possible because though generally the karmakanda rituals are meant to satisfy demigods, even in so doing, Lord Krishna must be worshipped in all yagas as the supreme authority, as the chief beneficiary. It is stated also in the Bhagavad Gita that Krishna himself is the beneficiary of all kinds of yagas. Bhaktaram yaga tapasam sarva lokamaheshwaram sukhridam sarva bhutamam gyatvamam shantim richati. Therefore, ultimate satisfaction of the yagyapati, the lord of the sacrifice, Krishna, is actually the chief purpose of all the yagas, even the demigod yagas. All human beings should properly respect the higher authorities in the universe. And the best way to do this is by worshipping the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So human society is fully dependent on the mercy of Krishna and the demigods. This so-called independence claimed by some contemporary people, which is achieved by scientific advancement, is actually illusion. This may sound a little upsetting, but we should consider that without the Supreme Lord, there can be no profuse sunlight, moonlight, rainfall, breeze, without which no one can live. Obviously, our life is dependent on the supplies coming from the Lord. As we already mentioned, in the material world, everybody is forced to act. And material action always inevitably involves sin. So as long as we are in the material world, we cannot be truly non-violent. This is important to understand. Therefore, the law books, known as the Smritis, mention five kinds of sin, which everyone inevitably commits, no matter how unwillingly. And these are as follows. First, sins committed by itching, by rubbing, by starting a fire, by pouring water from a pot, and by cleaning the house. By these ordinary activities, we unwillingly kill many living entities. So even if we do not commit any intentional sins, this is enough. We must commit the above mentioned five kinds of sin. So it is our duty to accept the remnants of offerings made to Vishnu in order to escape the reactions of all sinful actions committed unconsciously and unavoidably. So, in order to save humanity from sin, the Lord appears as proper action, which is called sacrifice or yagya. Performance of sacrifice is the only way to make progress in life. Sacrifices are born of prescribed duties, which are described in the Vedas, and the Vedas are directly manifested by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Thus, the Transcendental Lord is ever situated in the acts of sacrifices. One who does not follow the regulations of this cycle and lives only for himself, lives a useless life full of sin, engaged in sense gratification only. Performance of sacrifice gradually transforms the selfish worker into a selfless person who acts as a matter of duty, without attachment to the results of his activities. His objective is no longer material sense enjoyment, but liberation. By performing karma yoga, this selfless worker, now karma yogi, becomes completely detached, not only from the fruits of his activities, but from the material activities as well. Now he can happily give up all material entanglement and just concentrate on direct devotional service. Still, in order to set a good example for others, he carries on his prescribed duties. So, this is very important. Generally, nobody works unless he is motivated by desires for sense enjoyment. Arjuna, for example, refused to perform his duty because he could not see how he will gain from the fight. To defeat this primordial selfishness of the conditioned soul, the Lord introduces the principle of sacrifice. If one lives only for himself, he lives in vain. In order to progress in life, one should learn how to serve others. The best way to serve others is to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In the previous chapter, Krishna already stated that Arjuna is not yet qualified to renounce his duties. Now the Lord reveals that even those who are qualified to stop working do not abandon their prescribed duties, because this will be a bad example for the common people. A self-realized person is motivated to act, although he is not attached to the results of his action. This is very important. This is not common at all. So his motivation comes from desire to serve others by giving them a proper example to follow. Of course, this serving of others is motivated by serving God. Even God himself acts as a matter of duty, because as the ultimate authority, he has to set the proper standards for all living beings. Although Krishna doesn't have duties, because he is independent, he is Abhigya Svarat, still he performs his duties. So the self-realized person should show others how to perform their prescribed duties for the pleasure of the Lord. Like others, sages who are in knowledge of the Absolute Truth maintain their bodies. But the difference is that the goal of their activities is to satisfy Lord Vishnu and not themselves. So, atheistic propaganda has tightly bound up the innocent populace in mean activities. But the learned man, the karma yogi, can show society how to perform all these activities for the satisfaction of the Lord. Arjuna's arguments against the war are symptoms of this material disease. These arguments, they originate from the desire to be independent controller, enjoyer, and best friend of all living entities. We may remember that Krishna already defeated three of Arjuna's arguments against fighting in this war. Arjuna's misplaced compassion was untenable because the soul is eternal and cannot be killed. His anxiety that as a result of the war he will not be able to enjoy life was defeated because happiness and enjoyment come precisely from performing one's duties and not from rejecting them. Arjuna's fear of sinful reactions was defeated on the same grounds. Now, Krishna defeats Arjuna's last argument, which was that the war will be the reason for unwanted population. Arjuna's argument was, if we kill all these seniors now, there will be nobody to protect the women. And when the women are not protected, they will succumb to irreligious activities, they will be polluted. And they will give rise to unwanted population, Varnashankara. So Krishna states that, in fact, unwanted progeny appears as a result of neglecting one's prescribed duties, exactly the thing that Arjuna was proposing to do. Therefore, the ignorant should not be encouraged to stop their work with words or with example. They should instead be engaged in positive activities for the gradual development of Krishna consciousness. Therefore, Arjuna should not retire now in the forest, because this will be a bad example for people. Those who hanker after the fruits of their actions undertake many hardships in executing their work. Their imagination wanders like the mind wanders sometimes when we chant japa all over the universe. And their mind dictates to them that they are the actual enjoyers. Therefore, without disrupting the minds of these foolish workers, the intelligent person should engage them in beneficial work for Krishna's pleasure. It may be the same type of work they are already doing. They have to change their consciousness only. The ignorant people think that they are the only doer. In reality, however, the soul is so small, 1/10,000th part of the tip of a hair, that the soul cannot possibly move around this huge body. Actually, this is done with the assistance of the material nature and with the sanction of the Supreme Lord. The tiny living entity can only desire and make an endeavor. To what extent his desire will be satisfied, this is up to the Lord. However, by the influence of his false ego, the conditioned soul imagines himself independent and takes full credit for his illusory achievements. His only goal is sense gratification. On the other hand, the person in knowledge understands the difference between activities motivated by egoistic sense gratification and those motivated by desire to please the Lord. Therefore, although his ears, eyes, and other senses are involved in this material world, he refrains from material activities. He understands that the soul has come into contact with matter only by arrangement of the Lord. And he always keeps himself aloof from close association with this material world, because he wants to elevate himself to the original spiritual position. So how can we attain such exalted position? Krishna told Arjuna to perform his duties with detachment. Now the Lord reveals his actual desire. Arjuna should fight surrendering all activities to Krishna with full knowledge of his supreme position, without desire for profit and claims for proprietorship, and free from lethargy. Full knowledge and freedom from material desires and lethargy indicates that Arjuna should be situated above the modes of nature. In other words, Arjuna should not merely perform his duties without attachment. Actually, he should perform his duties for Krishna's pleasure. With this important verse in this chapter, third chapter, Krishna introduces the main point of Bhakti Yoga, that detached work should be performed for him. This is the main topic of Bhagavad Gita, which is Bhakti Yoga. So this is very clear indication of the purpose of Bhagavad Gita. One has to sacrifice everything for the goodwill of the Supreme Lord. And at the same time, discharge prescribed duties without claiming proprietorship. So what will be the result of such sincere surrender to the will of the Supreme? The sincere devotee is assured of full success, even if he is unable to follow all obligations perfectly. In the beginning of Krishna consciousness, one may not fully discharge the injunctions of the Lord, all of them. But because he is not resentful of this principle of following the authority and works sincerely without consideration of defeat and hopelessness, he will surely be promoted to the stage of pure Krishna consciousness. So this is very encouraging. We should not be discouraged if we cannot follow in the beginning everything. We should just sincerely try our best in devotional service, and Krishna will surely help us and promote us. On the other hand, there are many philosophers, mundane scholars who write comments on the Bhagavad Gita, but they don't have faith in Krishna. They will never be liberated from the bondage of fruitive action until they develop such faith. Krishna next explains that everyone acts according to his nature. It is better to be situated in one's position and try to attain Krishna consciousness under superior training. There is no use of artificially giving up duties. Of course, acting on one's natural position does not mean submitting to its particular weaknesses, manifesting as attachments and aversions. As long as the material body is there, the necessities of the material body are allowed, but under rules and regulations. And yet, we should not rely upon the control of such allowances. One has to follow those rules and regulations unattached to them, because practice of sanctification under regulations may also lead one to go astray, as Srila Prabhupada says, as much as there is always the chance of an accident, even on the royal roads. So we should not be attached to regulated sense enjoyment. Although it is allowed, we should not become attached to it. And on the other hand, we should always be attached to Krishna consciousness, to spiritual activities. One should perform his own prescribed duties in full Krishna consciousness rather than take up those prescribed for others. As already explained, there are two types of prescribed duties, material and spiritual. Srila Prabhupada explains that no matter material or spiritual, material prescribed duties are duties enjoined according to one's material conditioning, varna and ashrama. Spiritual duties are the duties given by the spiritual master for the transcendental service of the Lord. But whether spiritual or material, one should stick to his prescribed duties even up to death, rather than imitate another's prescribed duties. Duties on the spiritual platform and duties on the material platform may be different, but the principle of following the authority is always good, Prabhupada explains. So hearing about the glories of following one's prescribed duties, we become very enthusiastic and we decide to become strict followers of Dharma, of our duties. But life shows that such noble attempts are difficult to sustain. Why it is so hard to follow our prescribed duties? Arjuna asks this important question on our behalf. By what is one impelled to sinful acts, even unwillingly, as if engaged by force? The Lord answers, Kamayesha Krodayesha Rajaguna Samudbhava. It is lust only, Arjuna, which is born of contact with the material mode of passion and later transforms into wrath, and which is the all-devouring sinful enemy in this world. Lust is the perverted love for Krishna. As milk in contact with sour tamarind is transformed into yogurt, the love of God becomes transformed into lust. And the lust covers the conditioned soul in different degrees, slight, medium, and intense. Knowledge covered slightly by lust can grasp something of the truth. This is compared to the mode of goodness. Knowledge covered moderately, however, cannot grasp the truth. This is the mode of passion. Knowledge intensely covered by lust cannot even function and cannot even be perceived as knowledge. Lust cannot be satisfied by any amount of sense gratification. This is very important to understand. Just as fire is never extinguished by a constant supply of fuel, lust is compared to a merciless master who cannot be pleased, because of lust, the conditioned soul agrees to suffer in the material world. We're ready to sign up the contract with Maya. As long as we get a little bit sex enjoyment, we're ready to sign up for so many sufferings and problems. In the material world, the center of all activity is sex, Srila Prabhupada explains. And thus, the material world is called Maitunya Agara, or the shackles of the sex life. Like in the ordinary prison house, Prabhupada explains, criminals are kept within bars. Similarly, the criminals who are disobedient to the laws of the Lord are shackled by sex life. Advancement of material civilization on the basis of sense gratification means increasing the duration of material existence of a living entity. Therefore, this lust is the symbol of ignorance by which the living entity is kept within the material world. While one enjoys sense gratification, it may be that there is some feeling of happiness, but actually, that so-called feeling of happiness is the ultimate enemy of the sense enjoyer. So my soul expert, that she's keeping us in a prison house without even allowing us to understand that we're in a prison. If you are in a prison and you are not even aware that you're in a prison, you will never escape. You will never try even to escape from this prison because you don't know you're in prison. And why are we not aware? Prabhupada explains, because there is sex life and we attach to it. Therefore, we think, no, actually, this is very good. I can enjoy sex. And as long as there is sex, I'm happy to stay here. So according to the Vedic literature, there are four different ways to conquer over one's enemy, because lust is our primordial enemy. First, one should try to win him over by conciliation. Conciliation or offering of gifts. If this doesn't work, one should try to create dissension in the enemy's camp. And when this doesn't work, one should eliminate his enemy by force. So lust is such a terrible enemy that it can be conquered only by force. So why one may just skip the previous three methods altogether. So lust cannot be controlled by kind words or by division, because it is very evil. It is extremely powerful also. So it's evil and powerful. Bad combination. So it is extremely powerful because it forces one to engage even in forbidden acts that one has decided that he will not engage, by making one lose his sense of discrimination. This is crucial. One should know that lust is an enemy even while surrendering to its demands. An ordinary person sees lust as a friend because it facilitates his sense enjoyment. Therefore, people try to increase their lust even when they get old. They try to get Viagra or some other means to incite again the lust in the body. But the person in knowledge, however he knows, even at the time of the so-called enjoyment, that lust will become a cause of suffering. So therefore, lust is called the constant enemy, nitya vairina. It is the eternal enemy. Lust is an enemy because it covers our knowledge of the absolute truth. And its influence spreads in different places, the senses, the mind, and the intelligence. So how is that? We have two bodies, gross and subtle. Our gross body is made by the five gross elements, earth, water, fire, air, ether, and the three subtle elements, mind, intelligence, and false ego. We wrongly identify with our material gross and subtle body because of the influence of the false ego. We have false ego at present because sometimes, long, long ago, we decided that we have had enough of Krishna, of God. We decided that now we want to enjoy independently from Him. The false ego is a highly sophisticated technology which facilitates this desire of independent enjoyment. It allows the spirit soul to forget completely and for as long as he wants his actual position of spiritual spark, part and parcel of God, and that he is his loving servant. Otherwise, how can you enjoy independently from God if you don't forget God? The false ego enables the soul to develop instead a false identity comprising of material body and senses. It is something like a very good computer game which allows the player, the gamer, to completely forget his own identity and to fully assume the imaginary identity of his computer hero, the avatar. Isn't that nice? Once this is accomplished, the now conditioned by matter soul requires further instruments for fulfilling his lusty desires. There should be intelligence to discriminate between right and wrong. Intelligence, though it can be used for reversing this fall down of the soul by always choosing the proper action for the pleasure of the Lord. It is typically employed for discriminating between different options of material sense enjoyment, which is always detrimental. So, besides intelligence, there should be also a mind where the material flavors are tasted. After all, that's why we are in the material world, to taste these material flavors, rasas. We should have a network of senses by which the data that inspires such taste is gathered in the mind for combined relishing. Therefore, sex life is so absorbing because it allows all the senses to be in touch with their particular sense objects. Therefore, sexual activity is the activity that leads to the most forgetfulness of Krishna. And then we require a body which conveniently moves the senses near the sense objects. This is the vehicle. Driven by this archenemy of the soul, which is the lust, the senses of a materialistic person are always agitated and attracted by their sense objects. This agitation pervades the mind. The mind then orders the intelligence to design a plan by which the senses may unite with the sense objects in the easiest and most satisfying manner. The soul identifies with all that operations, but it's never really happy by it and never actually becomes truly part of it. Out of these three, the senses, the mind and the intelligence, the senses are the grossest and therefore easiest to control. Therefore, Krishna advises us to start the fight with our enemy by taking control over the senses. While controlling the senses, one should gradually drive away the lust from the mind and the intelligence as well. The mind should be flooded by topics about Krishna, and the intelligence should be strengthened by spiritual discourses. With spiritual intelligence, one has to seek out the constitutional position of the soul and engage the mind in devotional service to the Supreme to conquer the insatiable enemy called lust. This is possible because, as Krishna explains, the soul is the highest and can control all the intelligence, the mind, and the senses. In the material existence of life, one is certainly influenced by propensities for lust and desire for dominating the resources of material nature. This desire for overlording and for sanctification is the greatest enemy of the conditioned soul. But by the strength of Krishna consciousness, one can control the material senses, the mind, and the intelligence. While one should not give up work and prescribed duties all of a sudden, but by gradual development of Krishna consciousness, one can be situated in a transcendental position without being influenced by the material senses and the mind, by steady intelligence directed towards one pure identity. So this is the summary of this third chapter. In the immature stage of material existence, philosophical speculations and artificial attempts to control the senses by the so-called practice of yogic postures can never help a man towards spiritual life. He must be trained in Krishna consciousness by higher intelligence. So to sum up, again, in the beginning of this third chapter, Arjuna asked what is better, renunciation or work. Krishna answered that they should be combined in the form of working knowledge without attachment for the result. Even if one is unable to give up attachment for the results of his work, he should still perform his duties with attachment. This will purify him. And on the other hand, even those who are actually detached from material activities and their results, even they still perform their duties in order to give a good example to the common man. Arjuna asks why it is so hard to follow one's duties. It is lust only, replies Krishna, later transformed into wrath, which is the all-devouring sinful enemy of this world. It is by lust that one is impelled to sinful acts, even unwillingly, as if engaged by force. Only the weapon of transcendental knowledge can conquer over this lust. And the Lord will continue to glorify and describe this transcendental knowledge in the next chapter.